You hear plenty of stories about athletes overcoming obstacles to get to the Olympic Games, but some journeys take a few more turns than others. Back in 2006, American skeleton athlete Noelle Pikus Pace missed the Torino Games with an injury, and then 4 years later, she came up short of the podium in Vancouver. And since that time, her life has only gotten more crowded.
In the sleepy suburbs of Salt Lake City, Noelle Pikus Pace has an unlikely training program for a world-class athlete. But there is some running.
Yes, run, 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 run. Oh, God.
Lifting weights.
You're getting heavy. Who needs weight training when you have kids?
And an adherence to a strict diet.
Are you full? Do you have just a couple more bites?
I wake up, I get dressed, I get the kids ready, get them dressed. I'll take Lacey to preschool, and then I have a two-hour window where I have to get my workout in, and that's really not that much time at all.
I'll be back, bud.
And when I lift, when I run, my kids are right by my side. I take them to the track, and they're running around. I have to sometimes stop in the middle of the workout to take care of a crying baby or somebody's poopy, but it's great. I love it.
When Pikus Pace first became a mother 6 years ago, skeleton often came before family. But after she finished fourth at the Vancouver Olympics...
Oh, man. So close, a tenth of a second, you know?
She decided the pursuit of gold wasn't worth the sacrifice.
I actually retired the day after the Olympics in 2010. I was done with traveling and being away from them for 5 to 6 months at a time, and we wanted to have more kids.
Where's your coat?
Trayson was born March 23rd, 2011. That was one of the most incredible experiences of my life.
That's the peppers. You do the peppers.
Mama.
Nice work, sweetie.
In April of 2012, I got pregnant with a third. We found out that we were going to have a little girl. We were thinking of names and everything. I actually had a miscarriage. That was at 18 weeks. Being told that your baby's heart just stopped and you don't know why. Nobody knew why. They couldn't tell me. They didn't have an answer. It was really hard. Coming back to skeleton was definitely in response to having a miscarriage. It gave me something to move towards. We've been traveling as a family, and that's really the only way that I would come back to compete is if we could do this as a family.
Holy dynamite, that is fast.
She's back, baby. She is flying.
It's the best feeling to have them up at the top of the track as that green light goes off. Sometimes I just hear, Mama, 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 and they're crying. And I'm like, okay, focus. I'll see them in 60 seconds.
Noelle Pikus Pace and her family have enjoyed the success. They've endured the injury. They swallowed the retirement and rallied in the comeback. But the wait for an Olympic medal has been far too long. Now is her time. Farewell games, farewell drives, farewell runs are always special. This is it for Noelle Pikus Pace.
Did you see that moment? That moment of prayer there. She closed her eyes and had her last focused anticipation of what she wants out of this run.
In 2005, she won the World Cup. She was then hit in a training accident by a four-man bobsled. 9 weeks later, she came back, but she missed the Torino Games. She had to wait another 4 years for Vancouver and missed the podium by a tenth of a second. She's had to wait to now. This is her final Olympic run for that elusive medal.
Of these turns, what she's carrying with her is her family. The only reason that she is here today is because her and Jansen, who built her sled, that's her husband, decided that they wanted to give this one more go as a family together.
Noelle Pikus Pace has that Olympic medal.
Her medal.
She finally has it.
Oh my gosh!
did it! We did it! Nice job.
Woo! Oh, thank you.
Yeah.
Thanks, you guys. Thank you so much. So I'm actually going to just let you guys pass this around. So hopefully it makes back to me by the end. But I'm just going to start right here so that way you guys can see it. You guys, it's such an honor for me to be here at the CS100 Summit. Thank you so much for that warm welcome. It truly is a pleasure for me to be here. And man, don't you guys want to go up and try that now? Yeah, you guys are like only 30 minutes away from craziness on a sled. It's a lot of fun. How many of you guys have actually seen this sport in person? Yeah, we've got some. Awesome. Cool. How many of you seen it on TV? Now you have. Every hand should be up. Okay, cool. So just a really brief introduction as to how I got into the sport, because is anybody wondering that? Okay, awesome. I was 15 years old running track and field. I love track and field. I competed in 8 events in high school. I did high jump, long jump, shot put, javelin, the 200, the 100 meter hurdles, the 800, and discus. I love track and field, and I knew I wanted a scholarship in it, so that's really where I was putting my time. And during this time, it was the 2002 Winter Olympic Games, just before those games, and I had my track and field coach. He came up to me and he said, "Hey, Noelle, do you want to go up and try bobsledding?" And I was like, "Cool Runnings? Like the movie, you know?" And he's like, "Yeah, just like that." So I was like, "Yeah, sweet, that sounds great. I'll go up and try it." And I went up and I tried bobsledding, and I fell in love with the sport. I fell in love with the thrill of it. And the following year, my senior year, I went up looking for this big, you know, car type thing. And all I could see was a little cookie sheet on the ground. And he's like, "Okay, we're going to try something new today. We really want you to feel the ice. We want you to get a sense of what it's like to be really close to the ice." And so he stuck some lacrosse padding on my shoulders and a helmet on my head. And he said, "Okay, Noelle, lay down on your stomach." So I laid down hesitantly and still didn't know what I was doing. And he's like, "Just hold on to those handles at your side." So I'm like, "Okay, this is really just a weird bobsled drill." And he sticks his foot on my sled and he just kicked me off down the hill. I didn't even know what it was called. And I was screaming for my life. I thought I was going to die. I was like, hitting every wall. Woohoo! Woo! And I crossed the finish line. I threw my arms in the air and I'm like, "This is amazing. What is this called?" And he's like, "This is called skeleton." And I was like, "Why?" It's because it's the original skeleton frame of a bobsled. Oh, okay, good. You learned something today. All right. So I'm just going to tell you a couple stories, a couple lessons learned along the way to this Olympic journey. The first that I want to share with you guys happened just after I made the World Cup team. So World Cup is like the ultimate team, right? That's where they pick this Olympic team from. So it's the best of the best in the world are competing on this World Cup level. And I had just made this World Cup team, and now we're traveling all over the world from track to track. Every single track in the world is different, and we actually do steer, despite what it might look. It looks like we just lay there. Like, you're like, "Oh, that looks easy." You know, it's just like chance who gets down the fastest, right? that's what I thought at first. But no, it's opposite shoulder, opposite knee. We have steering bars in our sled, and we torque our sled the entire way down a mile-long course going 90 miles an hour with our chin less than an inch off the ice. And we have to memorize every single inch of every single corner of every single curve in every single track around the world. We have to study film. We study video over and over and over and over again. We look at timesheets. So they split up the track into timing sections. And we have to study it and break it to pieces. Where am I missing a tenth of a second? Where am I losing a hundredth of a second? And it's all about taking those tiny little pieces and putting them together and building on that. So I was just starting out on this World Cup circuit. I had competed here in Park City, Utah. I'd competed in New York, Lake Placid, New York, and then also in Calgary, Canada. And now I headed over to Germany for my first World Cup race over there. And I just remember so vividly my teammates coming up to me one by one saying, "Okay, no matter what you do, steer up and down and up in corner 4, because if you don't, you're going to flip on your back and you're going to crash. This is the most dangerous track in the world. It's Altenburg, Germany. It's on the eastern side of Germany. It's a really, really dangerous track." So I was like, okay, corner four, I can do this. Down, up, down. Okay, I got it. Because like here in Park City, I could take you guys all. We could go up there today, right, Dave, right? Let's do it. We could go up there today, and you could get down fairly safely as long as you steer down, up, down in corner six. Like if you, or even just drag your right toe. Just drag your right toe all the way around. You'll be fine, okay? You'll be fine. You'll cross the finish line. It won't be fast, but you'll get down safely, okay? But here in Altenburg, all of a sudden, I'm like, okay, corner four, that's the one that I need to focus on. So down, up, down. All of a sudden, Leanne, my other teammate, comes running up to me. She's like, it's not corner four, it's corner nine. You have to go down, up, down. Otherwise, you're going to flip over and you're going to crash. And then my other teammate, it's not corner nine, it's corner 10, it's corner 12, it's 13, 16, 19, 20. They're all just super dangerous. Like, okay, I can do this, I can do this. So I got my speed suit on, which is just a swimsuit, girl's swimsuit with like arms and legs. And guys, you wear it too. It's freezing cold. The coldest that I've ever competed at is negative 40 in Calgary, Canada. I can't remember if that's Fahrenheit or Celsius, but does anybody get that? No? It's the same thing. Okay, Fahrenheit and Celsius, it means negative 40. Never mind. All right, here we go. I know because I've been there. So it's freezing cold, and now I'm in Altenburg, Germany, and it's only like negative 10 here. Woo! And it's just freezing cold, and I'm just shaking, and I can't tell if it's because I'm so scared to go down or if it's because it's so cold outside, but there's two people in front of me. So the first girl that's about to go, her name is Eiko Nakayama. She's from Japan. Ohayo gozaimasu. Domo arigato, Mr. Roboto. That's how I remember that one. That's easy. Now you guys all speak Japanese, too. Okay, so this little girl from Japan, she's ready to go. She's actually not, well, she's littler than me. I'm kind of tall, but she's older than me. She's been competing for about 15 years, and she knows this track. She's a pro at it. She's going to get down just fine. That green light goes off. She sets her sled down. The guy in German comes on the announcement and says, "Die Bahn ist frei für Eiko Nakayama." So she sets her sled down and she takes off running. Run, 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 run. And she jumps onto her sled and she goes past the crest into corner one. So I'm trying to think about my turns. I'm thinking, okay, corner four, down, up, down, corner seven, down, nine, down, up, down, 10, 11, 12. And I look up at her time and it's going tick, tock, tick, tock, stop. And all of a sudden, the announcer comes on in German, and he says, Achtung, Achtung, 81, 81 in the track. So 81 means that she's crashed. She and her sled are going down at separate times, and all of a sudden, in the distance, you can hear an ambulance coming, woo, 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 woo. And Chris comes running up to me at this moment, and he says, okay, no matter what you do, Noelle, do not get in the Krankenwagen. Can anybody guess what Krankenwagen means? The ambulance. That's the first German word that I ever learned. And he said, do not get in the Krankenwagen because we don't know when we're going to see you next. It's not even a hospital. They don't have real doctors. It's a vet. They treat you next to the horses and the cows and the pigs. And there's these big needles, and we won't see you for like 3 days. Just do not get in the Krankenwagen, like no matter what you do. And I'm like, okay, 4, 7, 9, 12, 15, 17, 19, 9 Krankenwagen. Okay, I can do this. I can do this. Okay, got it. So now this next girl is up. She's a world champion, like numero uno in the world, world champion. She's about to go. She's from Canada. And they say, the bonus is fry for this was Deanna Panting. And Deanna, her time starts going. It's 30 seconds. You have 30 seconds to set your sled down, and you run, and you jump on it and cross that first timing eye. So her time starts ticking. She run, 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 jumps on her sled, goes past the crest, and I can't see her again because she goes into corner one. My heart is just speedily racing, and I'm sitting here trying to think about what I'm going to do in my run, and I'm thinking about what I'm going to steer, and I look up at her clock, tick, tock, stop. Achtung, Achtung, 81, 81 in the track. She flipped, she crashed, woo, 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 she went to the ambush. We did not see her for 3 days. 3 days, like I think she missed that race, and she didn't even have anything really wrong with her. I'm telling you, it's like it wasn't a serious hospital. So then I'm like, okay, I can do this, I can do this, I can do this. Okay. I got this, 4, 7, 9, 12, 16. All of a sudden they say, Zuban is fry for Noelle Pikus Pace. That's not my name. they can never say my name right. It's Pikus Pace. It doesn't matter. Okay, here we go. So all of a sudden, that green light goes off, and I just remember having this, like, panic moment of just thinking, like, if I just, like, sneak away, well, like, who's going to know? Like, who's really going to notice? Like, can I just, like, leave? Like, I really just don't want to go down. I'm the youngest one. I forgot to mention, I'm the youngest one on the World Cup circuit. Like, out of the whole anybody in the world competing, I was the youngest one. I was 19 years old. And I was like, okay, I can do this. I can do this. I can do this. So I set my sled down. That green light is starting to tick. And instead of, like, taking off sprinting, I was like tiptoeing down this icy ledge, and I'm like slowly getting onto my stomach, but then the ice, like, and you know, the inertia just starts taking you, and I'm just dragging both feet going into corner one. I was so determined to cross that finish line. I'm like, I don't care what it takes, I'm just gonna cross that finish line, just hold on really, really tight. So all of a sudden I start going into corner one, corner two. I came out of corner two and I hit the wall, and I'm like, ah, that really hurt. Corner two wasn't supposed to be bad. And then all of a sudden I go into corner three. Corner four, I completely spaced and missed my steers that Chris had told me to do. And I went up and down and I flipped onto my back, and I'm thinking, oh no, what am I gonna do? All of a sudden the next corner went the other way, so it flipped me back onto my runners, and I'm like, yes, I'm so good at this sport. This is amazing. So corner five, six, seven, eight, nine, I went into it, down, up, down, and I flipped back onto my back, and this time there wasn't another corner to flip me over, but I was still holding on super tight. And there was this long, long straightaway that's probably three times the length of this room right here. So I'm just flying down this little channel. And I remember being on my back, I could see the coaches with their cameras. And I could just imagine the German coaches are like, that's not how you do it. That's not how you do it, like filming us. So I'm flying down on my back, and I somehow muscled. So our sleds are 65 pounds. They're pretty heavy. And I pushed it back over, and now I'm flying on my stomach. And I'm like, yes, I just flipped twice. I had never flipped once, let alone twice in one run. I'm just going to put that out there. And I'm flying down this track, and all of a sudden I'm going into this corner called Kreisel. So this is the second German word that I learned. And Kreisel means circle. So it's a whole 360-degree turn. You enter in, and then you exit underneath where you entered. And it's massive. Like, it's at least the height of the highest peak of this room here. Like, at least. It's probably more than that. But it's really, really high and really, really big. And I remember going into this corner and just thinking, is it down, up, down, up, down? Is it up, down, up, down, up? You don't have that much time to think when you're going like 90 miles an hour. And I completely just missed it. So I'm like, you know what? I've crashed twice already. I'm just going to hold on really tight because it's worked for me before. So I just like gripped on really tight to my sled, and all of a sudden I just got sucked into the pressure of this corner. We reach up to 6 G's of pressure, depending on where you enter into a corner. If you enter from 6 inches to the left, 6 inches to the right, you can reach a lot of G-forces. And just forces your body down to the ice. It forces your helmet down to the ice. And a lot of curves, we can't hold our helmets up, so our helmet will actually drag on the ice. And it's not very fun. But anyway, I remember running, going into this Kreisel corner, and all of a sudden I immediately shot up to the roof and down to the belly and up to the roof and down to the belly. And I was coming up for my third and final pressure, and it started tapering. The roof started tapering at this point. And I remember just looking, and it's like the first time I noticed this big wooden plank at the top of a track. Do you know why they would have that there? So you don't go shooting out. I feel bad for the person that had to figure that one out. But I was sitting there looking, and I'm coming up for this third and final pressure, and I'm just looking at the wood, and I'm thinking, don't hit the roof. Don't hit the roof. What did I do? I hit it hard. I hit it hard, and I came flying through the air, and I was still determined to hold on to that sled. And I came crashing down on my back, and that sled, that 65-pound sled, came crashing down on top of me, and it just knocked the wind out of me. I couldn't breathe. So we're taught a couple things when we crash. The first thing we're taught, not if we crash, but when we crash, is to push that sled out in front of us. Because ultimately, we will come to a stop, and that sled will just continue moving forward. And I've seen a lot of really bad injuries happen from that sled crashing into the person. The second thing that we're taught when we crash is to constantly move our bodies, constantly move around, because it's a refrigerated system. So it's crystallized. The ice is crystallized, so it's really sharp and jagged, and it tears through your speed suit, it tears through your skin, and it'll go right to the bone, and it can cause really bad infections. So I pushed my sled out in front of me, and I still couldn't breathe, and now I can just feel it burning on my shoulder blades, on my heels. I flipped over onto my stomach, and now I can feel it, just my knees are on fire and my elbows, and then I finally got up to my hands. I'm trying to slow down, and it's burning through the palms of my gloves and through my hands, and it was really painful. And I finally came to a stop, and I'm trying to pick myself up off of the ice, and I could see that I was bleeding somewhere, and because I could see the blood just falling onto this like nice white ice beneath me. And I'm trying to catch my breath, and in the distance, I could see the paramedics coming. And I swear they were playing Chariots of Fire. Have you heard that song? Da, 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 da. And they were like these Germans with this blonde, wispy hair, like in slow motion. And all I could say was, Nein Krankenwagen. Like, yes, I did something right that day. So the purpose of this story that I wanted to share with you guys, it made a huge impact on my life, on my whole career. As I was starting, at that starting line, I knew that I wanted to cross that finish line. I knew that I wanted to get from the starting to the finish. And I knew I had to go through corner one, two, three, four. I had to get through all the corners to get there. But I didn't necessarily have a great strategy along the way. As I was going through this Kreisel corner, instead of staring exactly where I wanted to end up, I was looking at all of my doubts and my fears and everything that could hold me back from crossing that finish line. And I realized that where you look is where you go. Each and every day, where are you looking? Where are your sights set? Each and every day, what are you doing intentionally with your habits? Are you a slave to your habits? Are you just constantly waking up in the morning and just doing just to do because that's what you've always done? Or are you intentionally trying to shape your future and figure out where you want to go? Where you look is where you'll go. I started setting very intentional goals for myself each and every day. Something as simple as on the exit of corner 10 or Kreisel, I want to shift my gaze. Like even if it had nothing to do with the stairs along the way, I just wanted to be very intentional about something. And I started saying, I want to shift my gaze from looking at the roof to going into the entrance of corner 11. So now I'm looking for corner 11 and I could steer myself to where I wanted to go. Made all the difference in the world. So I just want to ask you guys, how many of you guys have any goals for yourself? How many of you guys have a goal for yourself in any area of life? Awesome. How many of you don't, but probably should? No, just teasing. Good job, all of you guys do. How many of you guys have ever set or have set right in this time frame a 30 to 90 day goal right now? How many of you guys have a goal set for within the next 30 to 90 days? Awesome. How many of you guys have broken it down into something that you want to accomplish this week besides attending this awesome conference and walking away with a lot of great information? Awesome. Very cool. So research shows us that we are 80% likely to fail if we set those year-long goals, those New Year's resolutions, right? It's okay to set a year-long goal. It's okay to set a five-year projection, a 10-year. That's okay, but as long as we are breaking it down into smaller chunks, that's when the real success takes place. So I'm going to take you guys for a ride. Do you guys want to see what it looks like from my point of view on a skeleton sled? Okay. I want to see. Let's see if anybody can guess how many turns this track has. Okay, so I'd run, 14 steps, jump onto my stomach, try and be nice and aerodynamic. I'm getting my head as low to the ground as possible, making sure my toes are nice and pointed. A light steer with my left shoulder, looking for that exit right there, letting go of my right shoulder, taking a deep breath out, holding that right shoulder down, countering with my left, coming into this corner, down, up. It's a little tougher. He hit there. That's not very fast. So now down, up, down, down, up, down, counter with my right shoulder, down, up, down, come across to this corner, down, wait, down, a lot of bobsleds flip right here, coming down, now coming into this corner called shady, down, up, wait, down, push it out, this gets you shooting across into this corner, which this one you actually get airborne, you come flying off your sled and you have to hold your form, coming across, down, up, down, I drop my left toe to make sure that I don't hit that right wall, take a deep breath out, hold really, really still, down, up, wait, down, bobsleds flip in this corner all the time as well. Steer with my left shoulder, down, right, left, hold it up, come down, and now I'm turning and I'm straining for that finish line with my neck and then I cross it, and now this is the scary part, stopping. So anyway, and then you push up off your sled and that's the run. Do you guys like that? That's a lot of fun. How many corners do you think there were? 17, 18, 16? No other guesses? Come on. A little bit more. 20. Good job, 20. 20 corners. You guys were really close, though. But it's hard, right, to count, and it's hard to pay attention to where you're at. And when the first, we were just talking earlier, it takes a few hundred times going down the track to where you can actually see it, and you can slow it down in your mind, and then it becomes an amazing thing, because I can go down these tracks, and instead of seeing it, and I can break it down into just this finite space of time where everything is just in slow motion, and it's pretty cool to do. All right, so a list of goals is not a strategy. I love this quote. Just talking about how I want to go from being at the starting line to crossing the finish line, I can't just say, all right, I need to get through corner one. Okay, then I need to get through corner two. You can see how many steps are taking place between each corner, between each curve. It's no different than the goals we set with our customers, with our teams. We need to be as specific and as detailed as possible. I'm not saying to micromanage, but I'm saying to allow it, others and yourself to break it down into the smallest pieces so now you know what to work on each and every day and being intentional with that time. So I looked for a long, long time for a goal-setting method, a goal-setting strategy or model that could help me to achieve my dreams and my goals. I absolutely love goal-setting, and I've been passionate about it for many, many years. And I followed the SMART method, specific, measurable, attainable, realistic, or relevant, time-based, right? There's OKRs. There's big, hairy, audacious goals, BHAGs. There's a lot of different methods out there. But I found that none of them were consistently effective in an everyday life or just the day-to-day grind. And something very, very important, so I created this model, and something very important that seems to be lacking from nearly every model is the P, purpose. Why? Why are you doing what you do? Why have you set the goals that you've set? This could be in an individual life. This could be within your teams. If you're just doing it because that's what's been done before, then it's time to rethink your purpose. It's time to rethink the why behind what you're doing. Because I promise you, this purpose, it will get you through those hard days. It will wake up. It'll wake you up in the morning and say, that's what I'm going for. This is why I'm doing what I'm doing. That purpose will carry you through. Aim is making sure that all of your pieces are put into one direction. Just like in skeleton, I can't be running in a straight line. If my feet are turned this way, my hips are going side to side, my head is bobbling up and down, you have to make sure all of the pieces are moving into one direction. Construction is taking it from that 13,000 foot view, like you have a year-long goal, and now saying, what can I do every quarter? What can I do in the next 3 months? What can I do in the next 3 weeks? What can I do this week? What am I going to do today? Breaking it down into tinier and tinier pieces. And then this one's extremely important as well. E, for everyday action and accountability. This is where laziness oftentimes gets the best of us. This is where complacency oftentimes gets the best of us. Or priorities, lack of putting our priorities in order. Everyday action and accountability. Be intentional each and every day. I love this quote. This is from Jim Schlechter. He's the president of Inc. CEO Project. And he says, the seven secrets of successful people. I have found that the best CEOs are always striving to find balance in their lives. That's what makes them great leaders and good people. Highly successful people measure themselves on seven key elements: health, family, social, financial, business, civic, and spiritual. They try to maintain a balance between these elements to live a healthy and fulfilling life. How many of you guys have found that to be true in your own lives? You kind of find that when you're out of whack in one area, it's kind of taking its toll in another area, and we have this constant trying to balance our lives. Sometimes we don't even know what's out of whack. Sometimes we're like, I'm just frustrated. Like, there's no time for anything, and I don't even know where my time's going, right? It can be extremely frustrating. So I'm going to try something for just a second. This is called the Wheel of Life, and this is a great tool to use if at any time in your life you're thinking, where can I focus my time? Or maybe you're thinking, I don't really have a personal goal right now. I don't know where to start. I'm just feeling like I need to start somewhere. So this goal, you might not be able to read some of these, so I'm going to read them out loud for you, okay? So what you do is this is like a target wheel, right? The closer to the center you get, that means you're really not satisfied with it. So the number one, if you give yourself a number one in this area, that means, man, I am not doing very well in this area. And if you give yourself a 10, you're saying, that's exactly where I want to be. So I just want you guys to think about each of these for a second. I'm going to state it out, and I'm going to give you a second to think about it. Where would you rate yourself in, we'll start with health, your health. And I am not going to define this term for you. You get to think of health in any way or capacity as that you choose to do so as an individual. But health, where do you fall on a scale of 1 to 10? 1 being, man, my health is extremely poor, and it's just miserable. And 10 being, I am exactly where I want to be with my health, and it's amazing. It's perfect. So just think about that. On a scale of 1 to 10 for your health, how do you feel like you're doing? So 10 is best and 1 is not so good. So you don't want all of yours to be right in the center of this bullseye, right? That would be a really pretty depressing life right there. You know, I feel sorry if you're there. I'll give you a hug afterwards. But 10 is like the optimal. You want to try and fill it in, but be as honest as you can. So health, on a scale of 1 to 10, 10 being amazing. Next, we're going to move to family. And like I said, this is all for you to define, whatever family means to you. On a scale of 1 to 10, where would you rank yourself for family in your life? 1 being non-existent, it's not doing great at all. 10 being it is incredible. The next one is fun and recreation. Fun and recreation. Scale of 1 to 10, where are you at in your life? 10 being awesome, 1 being not at all. Okay, so we've had health, family, fun, and recreation. Now we're moving on to relationships. Relationships can be defined in any way. It could be a spouse, a partner. It could be those that you work with. But as long as you know what that definition is, you define that for yourself and just mark what relationship might be to you. On a scale of 1 to 10, 10 being awesome, 1 being you need to work on it quite a bit. Next, we have finances. Finances on a scale of 1 to 10. All right, and now spiritual. Spiritual. Two more to go. We'll go with personal growth and learning on a scale of 1 to 10. Personal growth and learning. And last but definitely not least, business and career. Business and career on a scale of 1 to 10. I just want you to notice from that quote before we discuss this for just a second, this can help teams. This can help individuals. If you have a happy team, if you have a happy team member, you're going to ultimately have happier teams. You're going to have happier outcomes and more successful outcomes. I've talked to many business leaders. I've talked to many Olympians, many successful people, and this really is a key for success in life, finding that balance. So I just want to throw it out there for just a second. What did anybody notice about their will or about their life? What are you noticing? Balance, right? Yeah. Anything else? Consistency. Awesome. Anybody else? Does anybody notice that maybe one side is lopsided and another side is having to give? I see some nods. A lot of times we're so focused on one area of our life that we have to give somewhere else. We only have 24 hours in a day, and I hope we're getting a little bit of sleep in there, right? So we notice that it's out of balance, but it'll shift from week to week, from month to month, from even day to day at times. But the more consistent we can keep it, this wheel can spin a little bit faster. If you have a flat tire, it's going to take you a lot longer to get to where you want to go. But when you find that it's a little bit imbalanced, I had a guy say, so if you're telling me that it'll spin faster if it's in, you know, a full circle, if I have all twos, does that mean I'm doing pretty good? I'm like, we might need to talk after. but just being consistent, right, and staying in balance. I'd like to share just one last story with you guys, one very important lesson. So going into the 2006 Winter Olympic Games, this was in Torino, Italy, I was going into this season ranked first in the world. Oh, you guys are too, stop. I'm just teasing. So I was expected to not only finally become an Olympian, but to bring home a medal, like to come home with the gold medal. And I would do interview after interview this summer before. So during the 2005 summer, I was doing interviews and they'd say, okay, so how does it feel to finally be able to go to your Olympics? And I said, oh, I still have to try out, but yeah, but you're gonna bring home a medal. I said, yeah, I'd be all excited about it. I was going on the Jay Leno show, Tonight Show, right? Good Morning America, USA Today, doing all these interviews. And I was just really excited and ready to go. Well, during our team trials, I still had to try out for the team, for the U.S. Olympic team. And during our team trials, I came down the track during a training run, and I had just finished, and I was sitting there at the end of the track. So the ice ended, like, right here, and then we had this platform where I would sit down and wait for my teammates, and we'd take a flatbed truck up to the top of the track so that we could go down the track again. And as I sat there waiting, one by one my teammates came down, and now there's five of us sitting here, and we're waiting for Lindsay to come down in her sled. And all of a sudden I turned and I heard a loud noise coming from the finish line. And the finish line was about 100 meters away. And as I turned and looked, I saw a four-man bobsled coming towards us. And a four-man bobsled weighs about 1,500 pounds. And they were coming flying up that outrun. And they can pull up on a brake. That back guy, he can pull up on a lever, and a claw can come down and stop them pretty quickly. But I could tell that they weren't slowing down. And as they came flying up this outrun, we all jumped up to our feet trying to get out of the way of this oncoming bobsled. And I was at the back of the pack, so my four teammates were in front of me, and there was a staircase to my back, the staircase to get up to get into this flatbed truck. So I had to take a step to jump past this staircase, and right when I planted my foot, the bobsled hit me from behind. And I went flying through the air 25 or 30 feet, and I landed on the asphalt. And I remember trying to jump up to my feet to see what had just happened. And I fell back to the ground. And I turned and I looked towards the finish line, and I could see my teammates, and it was just commotion, just chaos. They were screaming and yelling, and I could see the bobsled. It had flown off the end of the track onto the pavement, onto the road, and my sled was actually stuck underneath that bobsled. And I tried to jump up to my feet to run over to my teammates, to run over to see what had just happened. How did I end up over here? And I fell back to the ground. And that's when I looked down at my leg, and my bones were sticking out. My heel was touching my calf. In a split second, everything was gone. In a split second, my dreams, the sacrifice, the finances, the time away from my husband, the whole dream of becoming an Olympian was gone in a split second, and there was nothing I could do about it. So I'm going to lighten it up a little bit. It's too early for this gloominess. So I got wheeled into the ambulance, and I go to the hospital, right? And they're like, okay, so we've got to put this titanium rod down through your leg, which I actually still have. And they have to put screws in the side, and we've got to take into surgery. And I said, just do what you got to do. So I go into surgery, and they gave me like an epidural type thing that numbs you from the waist down. And all of a sudden I'm sitting here, and I wake up, and I look around, and I look down, and there are four or five doctors around me. And I look down again, and one of them has a mallet. They're hammering the rod into my leg, and I can't feel it, but I can see it, and I definitely didn't want to see it. And so I was like, what do I do? And a doctor started walking by, and all I could say was, excuse me, down here. And he's looking around, and he looks down at me, and I'm like, I don't think I'm supposed to be awake for this. And he looks at me, and he takes that little blue sheet, and he just pulls it over my face. I was like... I'm like, I can still hear you. So they must have given me more medicine after that or something, because I don't remember anything. But I got wheeled. If you have surgery soon, don't worry. That usually doesn't happen, so you'll be fine. But I got wheeled into my hospital room. And this is the moment that I will remember forever. As I got wheeled into my room, that was really the moment that it hit me, that my Olympic dream is gone. My teammates will go on the next day to train and to compete for this Olympic spot, and I won't be there. Many of them, I'm sure, were happy, because now this opened up a free Olympic spot for them, right? And I would still be sitting here in this hospital room with these staples in my leg, and it was just so swollen and so big. And that's when a tear started coming down my cheek. And right as this tear started coming down my cheek, my hospital room door flew open. And my doctor walked in, and she looked up from her clipboard, and she said, "Why are you crying? You have two choices. You can either look back and be upset and angry and frustrated about what just happened to you, or you can choose to move forward. Your leg is broken, and crying's not going to fix it." In that moment, I realized that I still had a choice to make. I've always known that I have my agency, that I have the ability to choose my path, my direction, my attitude, whatever it may be. But until I was really at the pit, when I felt like I deserved to feel this way, when I felt like I could just be mad, I just wanted to be mad, I wanted to be angry, I wanted to be frustrated. She put it in words that I would have never expected. I just wanted a hug, really, but it was exactly what I needed to hear. Because it allowed me to shift my mindset. It allowed me to shift my attitude towards the situation and say, yeah, I did have a plan. I did have my 90-day goal or whatever it might be to get to the Olympic Games, going from World Cup to World Cup. I had a plan. And now guess what? Getting hit by a bobsled was not in my plan. It just wasn't. Like, who does that? And so now here I'm standing over here, and now I'm looking at this direction. And I had a choice to make. I could give up. I could quit. I could look back and be angry and frustrated, and it would do me absolutely no good. Or I could take today for what it's worth and say, I am where I am, despite what has happened to me, despite what's gotten me here, and now I can choose to move forward. I can choose what I decide to do now and today and continue to move forward each and every day towards the direction that I want to go. I missed out on the 2006 Winter Olympic Games, despite walking 2 to 3 weeks after, which was unheard of. I started competing 5 weeks after having my injury in Austria. I ended up finishing fifth in the world before the 2006 Olympic Games, and I was still told I could not go to those games because I missed 2 races due to my injury. It was devastating. So my goals, they had to shift. So now my goal is now 4 years away. In that 4 years, I made it. My husband designed and built my sled. It would have been something he probably would have never chosen to do. People don't just do that, by the way. That's like saying you like made your own shoes or something. I don't know. Like, just don't do it. Maybe you did. I'm sorry. Maybe you did make your shoes. They look great. but he designed and built my sled. And I went on for my master's degree in between that time. I had a little girl during that time. I'd taken a year off between the next Olympics. And I went to the Olympic Games, and I crossed the finish line. And I finished in the absolute worst position you should ever finish in an Olympic Games. And no, it is not second. Do not tell me it's second. You see that medal. That's a pretty cool thing. It's fourth place, okay? It's fourth place. I finished fourth in the Vancouver Olympic Games. I missed a medal by a tenth of a second. A tenth of a second. That's, you would have to blink 10 times in 1 second, and it's the space between one blink to the next. I still can't blink 10 times a second. It's really fast. Okay. So I missed a medal, and I was done, and I felt like I needed to retire, and then you guys saw this video. And man, it's amazing what going through the pits can do to us. It can drive passion. It can either tear us down, or we can choose to move forward. And I had a miscarriage at 18 weeks, and my husband said, what can we do? Let's move forward. Let's do this as a family. So he designed and built me another sled. I think he just wanted to build another sled, but... He built another sled, and it was absolutely incredible. It was amazing. It was amazing. The Germans were like, wow, was ist das? Like, they were like so amazed by it. And the US team, they actually implemented some of the things that he created. And it was just a really cool experience to be able to travel the world for 2 years with my daughter and my son. We had 2 kids by then. We were able to travel the world for 2 years, in and out, from hotel to hotel. It's not as glamorous as it sounds, but you know. It was fun to have them there and to be able to just go and to compete and to do my best. And I was top 3 in every race during those 2 years. Every single competition, I finished top 3, which is, I had never done that before. I came back after having 2 kids. Here we go, moms. After having 2 kids, I had a full ride scholarship, D1, full ride track and field scholarship. And after having 2 kids, I came back sprinting faster than I did during my college years. Go moms, mom power. It was so fun. I got a clap for that, not for being first in the world. Man, you guys are a tough crowd. No, I'm just teasing. You guys are great. But I just remember showing up to that competition in Russia in 2014, after all the ups, all the downs, all the highs, all the lows, all the trials, all the successes, and just standing there at that starting line. And by then, I didn't have to think about what I was going to do. I just took a deep breath. And I knew I was just taking everybody with me, everybody that had been with me throughout all the years, my teachers, my coaches, my team, my family, my friends, everybody that had ever given me a pat on the back, and even those that had maybe discouraged me a little bit that had lit a fire underneath me. And I took that with me, and I remember that green light going off. They said my name right that time. I set my sled down on the track, and I took off running. And we had to do 4 runs at the Olympics, and you guys saw the last of those 4 runs. And I remember going down the track and just thinking, this is it. This is my final run. And that has been since, I haven't taken a run since that race right there. And I was going down one curve at a time, Each curve. And I remember coming out of corner five. You guys probably didn't notice it, but I do every time. I came out of corner five and I tapped that wall and I'm like, no, I hit it again. I come out and I hit that wall and that just slows you down. And I remember just in my mind thinking, I've got to be perfect to this point. I've got to be perfect. Because we don't know. It's based on a hundredth of a second. That can destroy our times. And I remember just going down 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And all of a sudden I'm coming across to the finish line and I stretched my neck out and we can't see. So I immediately pushed up off my sled to try and just strain to see any sign of how I had done. There's no clock, there's no timing, there's nothing there right when we cross that finishing line. And I'm coming uphill to try and slow me down. And as I come across the crest, that was it. That was the moment. I saw my coach come into the track and he threw his arms in the air. And I knew it was enough. Honestly, like, you don't hear Olympians say this very often. Maybe the media likes to hype it up, but I really didn't care. Gold, silver, bronze, it really didn't matter to me. I wanted to give my best. You can't really be upset at yourself for giving your absolute best and falling a little bit short. It's not fair to yourself. And I knew I had given my absolute best. And when I saw his hands go up, I knew it was enough. And I crossed that finish line. I couldn't get off my sled fast enough. I ran up. I gave him a hug. And all the volunteers were like, you need to go this way. And I said, no, my family's right there. I need to go see my family. And they're like, no, you need to do your interviews. And I said, I'm going this way. And I took my helmet off and I screamed. And also I'm like, I've got to go up that way. And I was looking around and it was completely packed, full of like spectators and cameramen and camera crews. And I'm like, the only way I can get to him is straight up. And I thought, okay, I can do this. I'm like, I'll have one of these moments. It was Valentine's Day, by the way. And I was like, oh, my husband's going to be there, and he's going to sweep me off my feet, and I'm going to have this little ding, you know, like. So all of a sudden, I'm like standing on the edge of the track, and I jump down, and all of a sudden, it was like a lot higher up. And I'm like, oh, no, that's really high. And I'm like, well, everybody's looking at me now. So I just ran up, and I jumped up, and I'm grabbing onto this. And I'm just hanging. I'm like, anytime now, anytime. He never came. He said he was stuck behind the British people or something. I don't know. Anyway. But I remember climbing up over that fence and being able to embrace my family, being able to embrace my kids and my husband, my parents and my siblings. And those that, I mean, they had been there. And all I could say was, as I grabbed my husband, is we did it. We did it. Man, it takes a lot of people for us to be successful as individuals. I know we can all attest for that. We can think of those that have helped us along the way, those that maybe have discouraged us, and some that maybe have discouraged us and helped us to become our best. But it takes a team. I had so many people there helping me out. When I look at that silver medal, it's not just a medal from a day. It's not just a medal from the Olympic Games. It shows so many trials, so many successes, so many memories, so many heartaches that it took to get there. I just want to close by just telling you how grateful I am for the experiences that I've been able to have in my life, for the choices that I've been able to have, even though one might be good, one might not be so great, and being able to choose, but that we always have the ability to choose. And I just want to remind you all that where you look is where you go. What are you going to do with what you have learned here at this conference? Are you going to leave it here and just walk away and say, oh, that was good, that was a lot of fun? Or are you going to actually take some of this home with you, build on it within your personal life, within your teams, for your customers? What you choose to do makes all the difference in the world. So best of luck to you, and thank you again. You guys are awesome. Thanks.
Yeah, give her another round of applause. Yeah.